What's up guys, welcome to another video. We've decided to change the setting a little bit rather than being stuck inside. Such a beautiful day, we thought we would come outside. Now, I apologize, but I'm gonna have to put some sunglasses on just purely because it's so bright right now. Let us know if you like this setting. Just thought it was quite pretty around us. We might as well sit out here. I know I look like I'm about to go to a beach party and I can only apologize. Today, we're gonna be talking about my biggest regrets or mistakes that I've made in the past, being lucky enough to have owned a couple of cars over the last few years. So we're gonna walk through all of the cars that I've owned and potentially the one thing that I actually really regret. Now let's start all the way back. I don't know how long you've been watching this channel, but if you've been watching it for a while, you know that the first kind of sports car that I ever bought was a Lotus Elise Club Racer, which I loved. I still think that's potentially one of the best kind of first sports cars you can get. It's only got, well, only, it's still quite a bit, but 136 horsepower, which doesn't sound like that much, but it weighs only about 850 to 900 kilos. So the power to weight is actually pretty impressive. And I bought that car for, I believe it was 32,000 euros. So it's still a lot of money, but it's a car you can get into and it gives you that full two-seater mid-engined experience, but not quite enough power for a young driver like I was, or still am. I'm not gonna pretend like I'm an experienced old veteran behind the wheel. But when you kind of start out, you want something like that which has just enough power for you to be able to enjoy it, but not enough for you to get in real trouble or do any crazy speeds. So I really enjoyed that car. Kept that car for a little over a year, I think, put over 20,000 kilometers on it. Loved it. I changed the exhaust on it, so I had a Lorini straight pipe exhaust, so it was, I mean, just obnoxiously loud. It's kind of like the classic first sports car, right? It was in matte black. I got it crazy loud. I put a ton of kilometers on it. I was daily driving it. Super hardcore car. And to be honest, I don't really regret anything about buying that. And I still stick to it this day. I do think that is the perfect first sports car. Those Lotus Elises, kind of the light, small-engined Lotus Elises, I think are just a perfect starting base. The one thing I maybe regret slightly about that one is having it in a matte paint color. Just because of the maintenance of that is a bit of a pain. You get stone chips so easily, and that was the only thing that I thought after a while, if I could go back and maybe get it in gloss black, and then, you know, you can always satin PPF it or something, although on a 30,000 euro car, PPFing is a bit extreme, but you know what I mean. That was the only thing that I kind of was like, meh, maybe I wouldn't do that again. But all in all, I mean, I put 20,000 kilometers on the car and I think I sold it for 1,000 euros less than I bought it. So yeah, it ended up being a pretty good car to buy, and I loved it. I have, you know, that was my first sports car. I had some the best experiences ever in that car. Then I actually stuck with Lotus. Lotus were incredibly welcoming to me after I'd bought the Elise. They were absolutely loving me. They told me about this new Exige. So at the time there was the Exige 350 that had come out, and we'd spoken about kind of working on something together there. But as the time went by, they ended up telling me that there was a Lotus Sport 380, which was coming soon. So I decided to go for that car, and I worked the Lotus exclusive team, which is kind of like MSO, but for Lotus. So you can kind of really personalize your car. Worked with them and we came up with this. I still think it was a nut spec. I still love the spec of that car. I have to apologize also if you hear noises around. Obviously, because we're outside, we can't really control what the neighbors are doing, but just thought a change of scene would be kind of nice. So yeah, so that was my second sports car and my first new car, because the Lotus Elise I'd bought with 30,000 kilometers, I believe. So that was my first proper brand new car. And to this day, my only ever brand new car. Specced it from new, and that's probably the car, my biggest regret with that is maybe selling it. Yeah, I really miss that car. That car was something special. I spent months designing it and speccing it with the Lotus team. Took a while to be built, and it was just fantastic. I mean, it was a huge step up for me. 380 horsepower, only 1,050 kilos, so not that much heavier, but a lot more power. It was bigger, the interior was nicer, there was carbon everywhere. I remember that was my biggest thing, was having carbon fiber in a car. And I guess to go with the theme of this video, what do I regret the most? There's in that car, genuinely, I may just be completely blasé and missing it too much. I really do not regret pretty much anything with that. As I say, the only thing I maybe regret is selling that, but I also think I sold it at a decent time where I didn't really lose anything on the car. So I think all in all, you know, I had some incredible experiences with that. It was my first brand new car, probably maybe one of my favorite cars I'll ever own. It's actually a friend of a friend who's now bought that car. So maybe one day, if I could justify it to myself, I would love to get that car back. yeah, I just, that was a great bike. Then from there was actually quite a big gap where I didn't have a car for a while. I was traveling quite a bit, and I ended up then kind of as a surprise getting an Alpine A110. So that was a car with so much hype when it came out. I love those lightweight, kind of fun, slightly underpowered cars. That's what I'd kind of always been driving, so I felt like that's what I had the most experience with and I really liked. So when the Alpine came out, I was super attracted to it. Growing up in France as well, French maker, great story. And I thought it would, you know, hold its value really well and potentially be a fun car I could put some miles on and not lose too much money on. That was a little bit of a mistake. So this is probably my biggest regret in terms of buying cars. Now, the car itself is great. It's got an incredible chassis, great steering feel, you know, 250 horsepower. I think it looks great. They got the retro modern look pretty spot on. The interior is stunning. It's a great car. So I actually bought it for list price when they were trading for maybe about £5,000 to £10,000 over list price. I was lucky enough to get one, which was going to be delivered kind of 2 months after I managed to put the first deposit down for it. And it was a little bit of a rushed decision potentially. So I you know, got the car, took delivery of it. And the one, I think, big mistake I made was I got the car in right-hand drive and UK regged it. The reason that was a mistake is because it being a French car, it blew up in France, became so popular here. They were selling for way over. Whereas in the UK, it kind of blew up at first and then died down, and they've been coming down ever since. The demand for them, as soon as it wasn't that hard to get them anymore, once they got past the Premier editions, they struggled to sell the cars. Thankfully, I'd got in mine as a Premier edition in blue, which is kind of the perfect resellable spec. But yeah, I do kind of regret that because in the end, I wasn't in London too much. I only put about 900 miles on that car and then ended up selling it for basically what I bought it for. So that wasn't the wisest move in terms of buying. If I had gotten it in left-hand drive, I probably would have been able to sell it for about 10,000 more in France at the same time. So that was definitely a mistake, getting the car right-hand drive. But you live and learn. Some cars are so much better to have in right-hand drive because they're so much more rare and the demand for them is so much higher in the UK. But this was one where I made the wrong call there, and I should have thought of the French market going up, and the cars are still doing so well in France, just not that well in the UK. So I would actually say that's probably my biggest regret in terms of buying a car. Getting an Alpine right-hand drive, messed that one up. Still a great car, still did 900 miles in it, which doesn't sound like a lot, but I basically was just driving it around London. So 900 miles in London is a fair amount. And yeah, so then I could see that, you know, they were starting to kind of come down really quickly. So I panicked a little bit and I was like, I before this car ends up, you know, going down and being in the 40s stuff, because I bought it for £52,300. Before these start going down to the 40s, I'm just going to get out of it. I don't think I've got the right one. I got the right-hand drive. I don't think that was a good move. I don't think the market for these is going to last too much longer in the UK. So, you know, I'm not going to make a loss on it. So I might as well just give it back. And there we go. So that's what I did. And then again, there was a big gap. And then I bought the cars, which you guys know now, the R8 V10 Plus manual and the 430 Scuderia. So I can't really talk about these too much yet, obviously, because I've still got them. And so far, touch wood, I'm really happy with them. And honestly, no regrets. You know, alongside the Exige, I'd say they're my two favorite cars I've ever owned. The 430 is like just such a visceral experience. And the R8, I love the fact that it's a naturally aspirated V10. And I also just love the fact that it's manual. And there only being now, I believe, 6 left in the UK, because some have been crashed, V10 Plus manuals. You know, the rarity of that means the value is going up. And Scuderias, I mean, you guys know that those are, you know, kind of a fairly sought after car. So hopefully those will have both been good decisions. And they're both cars that I'm using quite a bit. So here I basically daily drive the Scuderia. And when I'm in the UK, I literally, it's the only car I have there is the V10 Plus. So when I'll look into a car, I'm not like trying to flip a car or get a car and hardly ever drive it and then just sell it and try and make a buck on it, which is why it kind of killed me with the Alpine, because I felt like I couldn't enjoy that car enough. For me, the dream scenario is you get a car which you love, you drive it as much as you want, and you sell it and you just don't lose anything. It's not necessarily about making a bunch, it's about how can I get a car that's gonna lose as little as possible. It's effectively the scenario. So yeah, that's pretty much it. We were talking about this over dinner the other day with some of the people I'm quarantined with, and I was like, this might be something that interests the audience. What's my biggest regret, or what are some of my regrets driving? I'd say, what are some of my regrets buying these cars? The matte black Lotus, wouldn't do matte black again. The Exige, honestly, I mean, I've been trying trying to think about it. Maybe the only thing I would have changed with that is I would have spec'd the titanium exhaust. I didn't spec that because it was 6,000 pounds or something. Didn't change the sound too much and was only about 19 kilos lighter. So it didn't, like, on a car that's already 1,050 kilos, it didn't make a huge difference. That's maybe the only thing I would have changed on that car, because to resell, that added, that made it a little bit harder to resell because it didn't have the titanium exhaust. The Alpine, as I mentioned, right-hand drive, bad decision. And then the two I've currently got, I'm very happy with. Touch wood. So yeah, hope you found this interesting. Just thought we would go through all of the cars. Hope you take it in the right way, not me trying to be like, oh, look at all of these cars. Hopefully, if you're looking into buying any one of these or any car in general, there are a few lessons that you can learn, so you maybe don't potentially make the same mistakes that I've made. It's very easy to sit here and, you know, do videos on the best investments and things like that and kind of sound like a know-it-all guru. But the fact is, you know, we're all learning every day. It's such an unpredictable market. I think it's just as important to share the things you've learned just by being surrounded by people sort of in this industry and talking about cars 24/7 to people who maybe kind of dip in and out of this. You can help them, kind of guide them in the right direction, which is what I try and do a bit with the channel. But yeah, it's just as important to kind of talk about the things you've done wrong and the lessons you've learned by making mistakes over the years, because at the end of the day, that's how you learn the best. Anyways, hope you enjoyed this. Let me know if you like this new surrounding, and we'll be back with another video again very, very soon. Cheers, guys. Bye-bye.